Hello and welcome. Thanks for joining us here at Encounter. As we get to sing these prayers together, we just invite you to sing along. When darkness tries to roll over my bones, we remember the joy that we have in the Lord as we stand in His love.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken.
My fear,
'cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Hey! She no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. I won't be shaken, I won't be shaken. Yeah. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
There's power that can break every chain.
Oh, there's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out the grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's this power in your name. Oh, there's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out the grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. There's power in your name.
Come on.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance.
Sing this reminder, but in the valley, God is near to us.
Oh, in the valley, oh God, you're near. Oh, in the quiet, oh God, you're near. In the shadow, oh God, you're near. Yes, at my breaking, oh God, you're near. Oh God,
my searching. Oh God, you're near. In my wandering, oh God, you're near. When I feel alone, oh God, you're near. Oh, at my lowest, oh God, you're near. Heart, we are joined as one by your blood. Hope will rise as we become more than conquerors through the one who loved the world. Height nor depth can separate us. Height nor depth nor anything else pull us apart. We are joined as one by your blood. Oh, and hope will rise as we become more conquerors through the one who loves the world. Oh God, never leave my side.
Thanks for joining us at Encounter. If you have any problem with our live stream, just head over to our webpage and you can find the video there. We're so thankful for your faithful giving during this season. Because of your support, we're able to continue our mission here in our community as well as around the globe. During the month of October, we collect a special offering for our missionaries to bless them at Christmas. If you'd like to be part of that, head over to encounterlife.org/give and choose Christmas for Missionaries from the drop-down menu. Moms, I just want you to know that our hearts are with you during this time. We know it's a really hard season and we've been praying for you. And while we can't gather together for MOPS and Moms Next, we are excited to launch Mama Meetups. We have a group of fabulous mentor moms who are willing to open their backyards or space here at our church or virtual space to host gatherings. Whether you're a new mama or you have a house full of kids, we'd love for you to come and be a part of a small group. We know this is a hard time, and we really believe that by coming together in small groups, we're praying you'll be encouraged and you'll find joy and you'll be excited for when we can meet again. So we're kicking these off in October. Head over to our website where you can sign up today and be a part of a Mama Meetup. Thanks for joining us.
Hello, Encounter family. Thank you for joining me. I've got a great announcement to begin with here this weekend, and that is that next weekend, weekend of October 24 and 25, we're going to be making a change to our weekend services. We will no longer be having a Saturday evening gathering outside on the 24th because on the 25th, we're actually moving indoors. We're going to be having our 9 o'clock and our 10:45 service indoors. So go on our website, get all the information about that because you'll want to get registered for that because we have to comply with the new guidelines. So we have limited seating. We have two service times though. So just go on anytime after 8 o'clock Monday morning and you can register for that following weekend. There's also a way to get to download notes after Friday before the weekend and so forth. So I'm really excited about this opportunity to gather with you in person in our auditorium, kind of a step forward, and I think it's going to be great. There's also a limited children's program. So when you're registering, just register those, like if you have infants with you or anybody that's going to be with you in the weekend service, actually in the auditorium. But then if you want to, if you have kids between the ages of 2 and 6th grade, they can be a participate in our child care program outside, playing on the playground and so forth. So there will be a separate registration for that you'll see on our website. So we just want to get everybody registered who's coming into the auditorium for the service. We're also working on something else. We're working on trying to get some TV screens put up outside so that we could have an overflow out onto the patio so that when the weather's decent, we could also set up, people could set up lawn chairs out there and watch the service from out on the patio. So just a couple changes coming up. Just pay attention to these because as things change, we don't want to leave anybody out. And if you get this message, you're hearing this, and you could think of somebody who might not be engaging this weekend and may just need this information, please just get on social media and let them know about these changes because that's the way we can keep getting the word out about all these things. Well, we've been in this great series in the book of Ruth in the Old Testament. If you've been here with me, you know it's an incredible story. And you've also noticed that it's sort of ramping up into kind of a cool love story. This last, late spring, Lori and I got into a Netflix series called Crash Landing on You. I don't know if you've seen it, but it's kind of a romantic comedy, and I'm not really typically drawn to romantic comedies. But it was one of those things where you watch one and you're like, I don't know. And then you watch another one, it's like, okay. You watch a third one, it's like, okay, I'm hooked. This is going to be really good. And granted, it is a South Korean romantic comedy. So it's very melodramatic. It is totally unrealistic. And it is in subtitles. So you might be thinking, why in the world would you watch that? Well, I kind of got pulled in. And it really ended up being an amazing show. The Book of Ruth really comes down to a love story, but it's not just a love story between Ruth and Boaz. It's emblematic of a much bigger story going on for you and me. It's like a picture, a type, a symbol, the great love that God has for us as well. So just know that that's always running in the background as we see this story in the Old Testament. Just to give you a quick briefing on where we've come so far, Elimelech was a man who lived in Bethlehem with his wife Naomi, and a famine was in the land, so they decided to go to enemy territory, the land of Moab, to seek refuge. But that was a bad move. They were leaving the land that God had given them, and they were choosing to go to this land of foreign gods rather than just trust the God that was the God that had given them the land there in Judah. So they go to Moab, which they shouldn't have done, and they went with their two sons. In Moab, it turns out that Elimelech dies. His two sons marry Moabite women, which again was wrong for the Jewish people. They weren't supposed to be marrying people from Moab. God had already warned them about that. And then the two sons die. So now Naomi, this widow, is left with her two daughter-in-laws, who are also now widows, which puts them all in a very precarious situation without husbands, without sons to take care of them in the future. It's just a really bad scenario. In that setting, Naomi hears that God is blessing his people back in Judah again, so she leaves to go back. Ruth ends up going back with her, one of her daughter-in-laws, and that's where Ruth makes a break from her past. She says, Naomi, your people will be my people and your God will be my God. And from there on, the story kind of takes another turn. It's like you just see the hand of God orchestrating all these things that are happening in Ruth's life. They get back to the land and they are destitute. They are starving. And Ruth says, I'm going to go out into a field and glean, meaning I'm going to just pick up the leftovers from the harvesters. So she does that. And it turns out that she's gleaning in a field of this man's name, whose name is Boaz. And it turns out that he is noticing her. She's really thankful for his provision, for his protection, and so forth. So you sort of feel the story getting a little bit steamier, but you're not really sure where all this is going to go or how it could possibly turn into a real romance. But that's where we pick it up in Ruth chapter 3. So if you would, turn your Bible, go to Ruth chapter 3. If you're having a little trouble finding it, don't worry, just use the table of contents. And it says there in Ruth chapter 3, verse 1, one day, Ruth's mother-in-law, Naomi, said to her, my daughter, I must find a home for you where you'll be well provided for. Now, Boaz, with whose women you've worked, is a relative of ours. Tonight, he'll be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. So Naomi is coming up with a plan. She realizes that, man, this is getting a little bit worrisome. You've been out here gleaning now in Boaz's field for maybe 6-7 weeks, and barley, wheat harvest is coming to an end. Now they're threshing the wheat on the threshing floor, separating the chaff from the wheat. It's kind of a time of harvest, celebration. But the opportunity to glean in the field behind Boaz's workers is coming to an end. And Naomi's getting a little concerned. She's just worried that there's not going to be any opportunity coming up for Ruth. So I was thinking about this, and I was thinking about how every real love story has an obstacle. I mean, think about Ruth. I think she wishes that Boaz would, you know, maybe fall in love with her, propose to marry her, at least certainly offer to take care of her and her family in some way. But she doesn't know what to do about that. And it makes me think about all of you who are maybe single, or you're in a situation where you wish you could be married, or you just maybe even wish you could find some dates, and you're just not sure how to move forward. Or maybe you're in some other complicated relationship and you're not sure how to move forward. I just want you to know that God really does, he's really in charge of your story as well. He cares for us, even in these difficult life circumstances. I mean, Ruth had a really, really bad past. Remember, she came from this land of Moab, where they're all pagan, idol-worshipping people. And now she's here with the people of God, the Jewish people. And I'm sure she just feels like, there's no hope for me. Who's going to pay any attention to me? I'm a foreigner. I've got this sketchy past. There's just no hope. And I think about all the people in our own culture today that are just feeling that. Maybe they had a bad childhood. Maybe they had a bad adulthood. Divorce and addiction and all sorts of problems that people come out of. So they have baggage and they wonder, God, where is God in all this? And does he have a plan for me? And is there a future for me? Is it possible that I could still find love in this world? I think there's a lot of people in that situation. And that's certainly where Ruth was at, which reminded me of a quote that I heard many years ago from Chuck Swindoll, and I pulled it out so I could read it to you here. It's a little bit long, but just hang in there with me. I think you'll see why I wanted to read it to you. It's really good. He writes, bottomless despair does not have to be our lot indefinitely. The scars need not be permanent. Christ desires to meet us in those dark corners and lift us to safety by redeeming our dignity and worth. His grace is greater than our shame. Where sin abounds, grace superabounds. He becomes for us our personal shame bearer who walks us through those harsh, agonizing days when we feel most alone and afraid. How can he do that? Remember, he's been there. He has felt the aches of indignity and humiliation. In fact, there's no limit to the depth of shame he can see us through, because there's no limit to the grace he can supply. I really like that. I think that's where Ruth finds herself in this story, unsure about the way forward, unsure about how God's going to provide for her, and yet wanting so much to just build a whole new life. here among the people of God. So Ruth's story, it starts out with the plan. Naomi's got a plan. Okay, think about it, Ruth. We're running out of time here. That man Boaz that you have been harvesting in his field, he is actually a distant relative of ours. Tonight, he is going to be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. So tonight, he'll take his turn on the threshing floor where they have all the wheat, and at various hours of the night, they do the harvesting in the day, and then at night, the harvesters will go in and take shifts winnowing the wheat. So they break it up, and then the chaff is blown away by the wind, and that's the process of getting the wheat out of the kernel of wheat away from the stems and the skin and all that. So he's going to be doing that tonight. So that takes us to the preparation. Naomi says to Ruth, wash, put on perfume, and get dressed in your best clothes. So this is getting exciting here. Then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know you're there until he's finished eating and drinking. So he's going to be kind of winding up from the day. He'll have his meal, and he's going to spend the night there. So Ruth, I want you to put on that Moabite madness perfume of yours, put on that cute little dress, and I want you to get ready to meet up with Boaz that evening. Look at verse 4. The text says, when he lies down, note the place where he's lying. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down. He'll tell you what to do. I'll do whatever you say, Ruth answered. So she went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking and was in good spirits, he went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. And Ruth approached quietly and uncovered his feet and laid down. Now, this is super unconventional, but it's not inappropriate. This whole idea of lying down at a master's feet was something that servants often did. And they would just take a little corner of their blanket or their coat or whatever and kind of pull it over them. It was very common. But in this case, it's actually kind of symbolic of coming under the care of Boaz. It's like Ruth is, by doing this, by lying down at his feet and putting a little of his cloak or his coat over her, she's kind of saying, Boaz, I'm just telling you, I want to come under your protection. So it's not a proposal, but it's sort of like she's proposing that he propose, is the idea. So here's the proposal. Verse 8, in the middle of the night, something startled the man. He turned, and there was a woman lying at his feet. Who are you? He asked. I am your servant Ruth, she said. Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are a guardian redeemer for our family. She is basically saying, Boaz, you are one in our family line that could provide for us. Would you be willing to spread a little bit of your garment over me as a way of just saying, Ruth, I will protect you? This is what she's literally asking him to do. It's very symbolic, and it's really kind of a beautiful symbol. She's already placed herself under the wings of God, it says earlier in the story, and now she's sort of placing herself under the protection of Boaz. And she makes mention, as we talked about last week, makes mention of this idea of a relative redeemer, meaning, or a kinsman redeemer, meaning that he's somebody in the family line that would be responsible for caring for that family line. If there's a death in the family, the husband dies, there's no way to carry forward the name of the family or the property of the family, then there's a relative that should step in and care in that situation and provide for that family. So she is coming to him and basically saying, would you do this for us? But she's crossing a lot of taboos. I mean, think about it. Here she is, a foreigner. She's sort of married into the family line. She's a foreigner. She's a woman coming to him rather than him coming to her. In that culture, that was just kind of unheard of. She's a younger person asking an older person, all sorts of cultural things that was just kind of weird, kind of put her in a situation where she could feel pretty nervous about this. So you kind of are left wondering, well, what's going to happen? So you get to verse 10, and you realize, wow, God is providing for her. Look at Boaz's response. He says, "The Lord bless you, my daughter. This kindness is greater than that which you showed earlier. You have not run after the younger men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All the people of my town know that you are a woman of noble character. Although it is true that I am a guardian redeemer of our family," dum-de-dum-dum, here's where it changes, "there is another who is more closely related than I. Stay here for the night, and in the morning, if he wants to do his duty as your guardian redeemer, good, let him redeem you. But if he's not willing, as surely as the Lord lives, I will do it. Lie here until morning." So he's basically saying, there's somebody else in the family line that's closer to you than me. And he actually has the first rights to be the redeemer for you and Naomi. Now, this idea of redemption, let me go just give it a little more context for that. Naomi, as we're going to find out, is going to have to sell off the family land. The land that was owned by Elimelech, her husband, would have been passed on to her son, Mahlon, who married Ruth. But Mahlon, remember, he also died. So Elimelech died, Mahlon died, so the land would have passed to Naomi. But she's starving. She doesn't have any means of income now. She's a widow in that culture with no man to provide for her. She has no means of income, so she's going to have to sell off the land, which means selling it outside of the family name, which was a big deal in that culture. You didn't want the land to leave the family, leave the clan. And so what Ruth is proposing to Boaz is that he actually buy the land, reclaim it for the family, which means you kind of get the family thrown in as well. Hint, hint, like, hey, Boaz, this could be a pretty good deal. You get the land and you get me. I mean, she's not saying that outright, but that's sort of implied in being a kinsman redeemer. But he says, you know what? That sounds really good, Ruth, but there's a twist in this Cinderella story, and that is that there's this other guy. He's actually closer to you than I am. Well, what if he wants to buy the land? What if he wants to redeem it for the family? And what if he wants to marry you? So look at verse 14. "So she lay at his feet until morning, but got up before anyone could be recognized. And he said, no one must know that a woman came to the threshing floor. He also said, bring me the shawl you're wearing and hold it out. When she did so, he poured into it 6 measures of barley and placed the bundle on her. Then he went back to town." So he's saying, Ruth, don't let anybody know that you came here. This is going to look bad if you tell anybody, but I want you to know that I'm going to take care of this. I'm going to see what I can do. And in the meantime, I want to provide for you. Here is an enormous amount of wheat, a really big gift for you and Naomi. And I'm sure about this time, Naomi's back at the house, just wringing her hands, thinking, oh my gosh, it's morning time now. She never got back. What did I do? This may have been a really bad decision. And then Ruth walks in. Look at verse 16. "When Ruth came in to her mother-in-law, Naomi asked, how did it go, my daughter? Then she told her everything Boaz had done for her and added, he gave me these 6 measures of barley, saying, don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed." There's something I want you to just take note of here, too. In the NIV, in our translation that we're using here, it says, how are you, my daughter? Okay? But how did it go, my daughter? Excuse me. How did it go, my daughter? But what's really interesting is in the Hebrew, the actual word-for-word translation of that is, are you still Ruth the Moabite? In other words, are you still my daughter, or are you now a prospective Mrs. Boaz? So there's a little nuance there in the Hebrew. It's like, basically, who are you now, is what she's saying. So here's the fourth point on your notes, the provision. Boaz has not only said, I'm going to do what I can to work this out, but I want to, in the meantime, I want to provide for you and your mother-in-law. I just see Boaz as this big-hearted, caring individual who is so tender in the way that he responds to Ruth, there on the threshing floor in that whole encounter. He's so careful with her. He's so caring for her. I love it. He's a man of honor, and he's a man of compassion. And I was thinking about that in just terms of all the people that are in our lives, the people that God brings into our path, that we have the opportunity of being like a Boaz to, somebody who cares for them, somebody who provides for them, somebody who just steps into their story and says, I want to do what I can to help you out. I think of compassion as the hands and feet of the love of Christ that is in our hearts for people. If we say we love God, the scripture says we have to love people. It just is going to come out of us. If we really love God, we really are going to have compassion for people. One writer writes, compassion asks us to go where it hurts, to enter into the places of pain, to share in brokenness, fear, confusion, and anguish. Compassion challenges us to cry out with those in misery, to weep with those in tears. Compassion requires us to be weak with the weak, vulnerable with the vulnerable, and powerless with the powerless. Compassion means full immersion in the condition of being human. I love that. That's Boaz at this point in the story. He's saying, Ruth, I just care for you and your mother-in-law, and I want to provide for you. Verse 18, it says, then Naomi said, wait, my daughter, wait until you find out what happens, for the man will not rest until the matter is settled. So now Naomi is waiting, more waiting. She's been waiting all along. When she came back to Bethlehem, she was waiting to find out how God would provide for her, and she decided to go gleaning. Then she's spending weeks gleaning with no idea where this is really going. More waiting. And then the harvest season comes to an end, and there's no answers. So Naomi comes up with this plan. At least go and let Boaz know you're interested. So she's done that. But now she's waiting. And so we'll wait too. Next week, the story continues and it lands. But I want to just draw your attention to a couple of key things here as we wrap this up. One, remember that Jesus said in the New Testament that all these stories in the Old Testament were ultimately pointing toward him. In John chapter 5, he's having a discussion with a lot of the rulers, the leaders, religious leaders, and he's basically explaining that the Old Testament scriptures point to him. Later on, after his resurrection, he's on the road to Emmaus with a couple of individuals. And again, he points out that those Old Testament stories, they're pointing to him. This story in Ruth definitely points to Christ. And her story is so much like our story. Her story is like symbolic of how we all come to Christ. I mean, think of Ruth and her scandalous past, living there in Moab, worshiping idols and all the stuff that went along with idol worship. And yet she's come into the family of God and she says, Naomi, your people are going to be my people. Your God is going to be my God. She makes a clean break, but she has no idea how God is going to be providing for her. In the same way, we come to God through Jesus Christ. We come without anything. We come destitute. We come with our scandalous past. But then his story takes over our story. So I want to just sort of wrap it up with thinking about our story and how God has provided for us, kind of the way Boaz has provided for Ruth in a very tangible way. God provides for us in a very spiritual way. Our story, God's plan, Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 3. It says, God says, I have loved you with an everlasting love. I have drawn you with unfailing kindness. Which leads us to God's invitation. Isaiah 55, give ear and come to me. Listen that you may live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you. My faithful love promised to David. Think about that. God is saying, I want to make an everlasting covenant agreement with you because of my love. So our story begins with God's plan, goes on to God's invitation, and then God's acceptance of us. Think about this. This is the same language we see in the book of Ruth. Ezekiel chapter 16, I spread the corner of my garment over you and covered your naked body. I gave you my solemn oath and entered into a covenant with you, declares the sovereign Lord, and you became mine. It's almost as if scripture is just this one big love story or lots and lots of little photographs of God's love all the way along. God's plan, God's invitation, God's acceptance of us leads to our redemption. Ephesians chapter 1, in him, that's in Christ, we have redemption through his blood. In other words, he paid the ultimate price to redeem us. The forgiveness of sins, in accordance with the riches of God's grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding. In other words, he knows us completely. He knows everything about us, our past and our future, and yet he lavishes his love on us. He has redeemed us by payment of his own blood, forgiving our sins and bringing us into right relationship with God because of God's grace. That's a magnificent story. It's our story. All the way through Scripture, these pictures of God's love for us. In Max Lucado's amazing book called No Wonder They Call Him the Savior, he shares a true story about a woman, a girl, actually named Christina. I think it's a really good picture of redemption. She grew up in Brazil, in this little village outside of Rio de Janeiro, but she just didn't like village life. It was hard. She was poor. She slept on a pallet on the floor, just had a wash basin, no running water, and a wood-burning stove. And she thought about life in the city and how exciting that would be. So one day she ran away. She ran away from her home and her mother, breaking her mother's heart, and left for the big city. Her mother, named Maria, knew what would happen to Christina in the big city. She didn't have any means of caring for herself, supporting herself. So she was afraid she would just turn to prostitution or something like that. So Maria got her stuff together and she went down to the drugstore and went into one of those little photo booths. I don't know if they really have those anymore now with iPhones and everything else, but they used to have these little booths you could go in and pull the curtain closed and take photos of yourself. She went in and took a whole bunch of black and white photos of herself. And then she got on the bus and headed to Rio de Janeiro, to the big city. Once she was in the city, she just started wandering from place to place, every bad part of town, every sketchy neighborhood, every street where hookers were walking and drug addicts hung out. She walked up and down those streets, and everywhere she went, she would put photos in key places, a photo on a lamppost, a photo on a mirror in a hotel lobby, a photo in a bus station. She put photos of herself all over the place. Finally, she ran out of photos, she ran out of money, and she had to go back to her village. So she headed back on the bus. And sure enough, in time, one day, Christina actually found one of those photos. In Max Lucado's own words, let me read to you what happened. It was a few weeks later that young Christina descended the hotel stairs. Her face was tired, her brown eyes no longer danced, but spoke of pain and fear. Her laughter was gone. Her dreams had become a nightmare. 1,000 times over, she had longed to trade these countless beds for her secure pallet. Yet the little village was, in so many ways, too far away. As she reached the bottom of the stairs, her eyes noticed a familiar face. She looked again, and there on the lobby mirror was a small picture of her mother. Christina's eyes burned and her throat tightened as she walked across the room and removed the small photo. Written on the back was this compelling invitation: wherever you've been, whatever you've done, please come home. And she did. I think about Ruth entering into this unknown land with these unknown people, with no idea what the future would hold. I think of what must have been going through your own mind and heart, feeling like, would she be forever single? Is there ever any love in this story for her? Is there any hope being a foreigner in this land? And yet God had a plan for her. The Bible is like a collection of photos of God's love all the way along, from beginning to end, all the way back in Genesis, all the way to the end of Revelation. God saying, I'm here. I love you. Wherever you've been, whatever you've done, please come home. I love you so much. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I thank you for this magnificent story that is so symbolic of your love for us. I thank you for the way that Boaz is reaching out in compassion to Ruth, even before we know yet how it's all going to unfold. And he certainly didn't at this point, and she certainly didn't at this point, but yet he cares for her and her mother-in-law. I just think that's beautiful. He's such a man of honor, and it's so descriptive of the way that you love us so selflessly, God. You've provided for us, and you have sent us a redeemer, one who has paid the ultimate price so that you could buy us back from the slave market of sin. And I pray today for anybody who's listening that they would see beyond the story of Ruth and Boaz and look into your eyes and see the love that is communicated through these kinds of stories in Scripture. And I pray that today we would be responsive, that every one of us, regardless of where we've been or what we've done, we would come home. We would come into that intimate place with you where we come in, lie at your feet, and pull the edge of your garment over us and say, would you redeem me too? Help us, Heavenly Father, to realize today your great, great love for us. And we thank you for this beautiful story. In Jesus' name, amen. It's going to continue next week, and I just want to say thank you for joining me here online in this space. And if you can, come to our in-person service in our auditorium on the 25th. God bless you.
From death, and I feel this rush deep. the Father, fall in the grave. Run with the hiding, breeze it away. And our heart needs a surgeon, soul needs a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again. I'll run to the Father, fall in the grave. Run with the hiding, breeze it away. My heart found a surgeon, my soul found a friend. So I'll run to the Father again and again and again and again.
Running to you. Thank you that your arms are open wide. That you invite us back as your adopted sons and adopted daughters. We remember today the kingdom that we are a part of, the family that we are a part of. Thank you for this opportunity we have to continue to worship together as your church here in Ventura County. In Jesus' name we pray together. Thanks again for joining us. We'll see you next week.